Well, kia ora koutou, it's Carl Burrows here from Haka Works. We're on Haka in the Matrix. I'm with Kane Harnett. We're going to meet to Kane in a minute, but just what is Haka in the Matrix? Haka, of course, is what we do. It's our culture. It's what we love. And in this particular case, it's representing our cultural knowledge. The Matrix, well, we all know the movie, and Neo, he makes his way through different worlds, and doing so finds his own life purpose. As we do, as we go through our own lives, navigate our own lives through different worlds, whether they're geographical, whether it's spiritual and temporal and real, and in doing so we find our own purpose, we discover who we are on that journey as individuals and communities. I think as Maori we've been given this these amazing tools from our ancestors to help us along that journey, and it's something that I want to share with the world. I know I'm talking to a lot of people who are in a similar situation, but you know, it's not always that easy. It's not simple. There are dangers and there are threats, and this is something we want to talk about and explore. And today, this is why I've got Kane Harnett from Haka X on with us today. Before I join with Kane, I just want to do a quick mihi mihi and karakia. And this is something I always forget to do, and this is to just let you know a little bit more about Haka X. We have Haka X started with a haka company called a haka performing group called Manaya, and that still operates. It's our haka performing team, but Haka X is really more about the corporate side of what we do. We help energize events and people. We help connect people to values and purpose, and help build teams, build cohesive teams for corporates and professional organizations. And if you want to follow us, you can Haka X and Manaya on Facebook. We also have a YouTube page. If you want to receive our email, just drop me a note here. You can on the side in Facebook and or in the message, and we'll put you on our mailing list. So our karakia today is going to be Waka Taka Te Ahau. It's about getting us in the right frame of mind to enable us to achieve what we want to achieve today. And our mihi mihi, of course, it's about acknowledging you all who are listening today. It's about acknowledging ancestors and the kaupapa, the reason that we're all gathered here today. So, tēnā koutou. Tēnā no oki koutou, ko hui mai nei tēnei rā, tēnei pō, aha koki hea I tāo. Tēnā koutou nama haramai, ko tēnei huri no Taranaki e mihi kauana. Tēnā no oki koutou, ko taimai lungi te kaupapa te wā, me ki ngā taonga tukuhi o ngā mātua tupuna. Tēnā no hoki koutou rā, me ngā mihi ki ngā mate o te wā. Mate haere, haere, haere tūrā. Rātou ki a rātou, tātou ki a tātou. Kia ora mai tātou. Waka taka te au ki tūru, waka taka te au ki te tonga. Kia mā kina kina ki uta, kia mā taratara ki tai. He hi ake na te atukura, he hiu, he teo, he huka, he hauhu, ti hai, Māori ora, tēnā ora kautou katoa. So kia ora Kane. Just before we get you in, I just want to say, if you want to say hi to Kane on Facebook, just drop us a note, say where you are, where you're listening from, and we'd love to hear from you. And if you have any questions for Kane as we go through, don't be afraid to type them in the message in Facebook, and they'll come through as we're talking. So ka huri ki a koe, e te tūkana, ngā mihi, nei mo haramai. Kia ora Kane.
Ai, kia ora, kia ora. Tēnā koe, Carl. Tēnā koe, hoa. Tēnā koe te kaiwhakatū o tēnei matapaki. E tēnei te mihi atu ki a koe, e tahi ana o tō whānau I rānana, rau tō whānau tūturu, ki raro iho te matapiki, tapu o te maunga Taranaki. Ka pai ki te a koe I tēnei pōnei, nō reira, nā mihi atu.
Kia ora. Awesome. Hey, just for everybody, we do speak a bit of Maori on the show, not a lot, but you know, it should be obvious from the context what we're saying. But if not, it's probably too complex for us to tell you what it means, so we're not going to do that. But what I'm going to do is just ask Kane to introduce himself in the way he would if he was back home, and then just give us an explanation. And that just really establishes where he's from and who he's from. Kia ora.
Kia ora. Just to take a step back to the beginning. As is tradition in the Maori culture, and especially in a situation where we come together to talk about a specific thing, we always mihi mihi, or we greet each other in the Maori language. And my greeting talked about how it was fantastic to see Carl again, especially in relation to to the interview that we're going to be doing tonight, which is very special because normally we just talk. So this is something new also for us as well. But also I talked about his family in London, and also hailing back to his connections and his family underneath the sacred peaks of Mount Taranaki. So that is a normal thing that we do. Nohe aho te he Māori ora. Ko mamuru te waka, ka kahu tia nui te tupuna wahine. Ko parata te tipuna, ko karikari te moana, ko te pū o te whekete maunga. Hahitai marangai te marae, te whānau moana raua, te roro huri, ngā hapu, ngā ngāti kahu te iwi. Ko Kane Harnett mūta saku ingoa, te hei Māori ora. So what I've just done there was talk a little bit about my background, where I come from, where my family roar from, as we say, up on the Karikari Peninsula in the far north of New Zealand. Talking about all of our ancestors when Maori meet, the way that we talk, we don't ask what you do. Basically, we talk about where we're from and we talk about our ancestors. And through our ancestors, we find that connection, and that's what we look for. And So basically through that, it gives Carl and a number of my whānau who are listening in, I hope, today, who can connect with that and react to the history and traditions of our family.
Tāpai. And I heard Ngāti Kahu, Ngāti Kahu koe, and that's up the north. So, you know, just from you talking about those things, you know, I get a general idea of where you're from, and I can relate that to your personality as well. And you know those traits coming through. So just a couple of people saying hi to you at the moment. So this is Tiaka Kahi from Buffalo, New York. Kia ora e hoa. Jackie Naylor's here in the UK from Oxfordshire. Cecilia say Morena. Cecilia Jardine King from Christchurch.
Kia ora, Cecilia.
And you've got a Gustav Rindestahl. Says kia ora.
The warrior.
And Mere Makene, saying kia ora from Sydney. One of our kuia whai Jerry from Surrey here in the UK. And and we've had this problem before, so this is what Cecilia is saying. She's saying, my phone is trying to translate te reo into Espanol. When it translates into English, it comes up with some really funny things. So I understand your problem. So we've got Murad. I'm from Denmark, and Gustav from Sweden. Kapoi. Okay, Ehua, so just tell us a little bit of, you know, you talked about Ngāti Kahu. Tell us about where you were brought up and your, you know, growing up in New Zealand, what it was like for you being Māori, all those sort of things. We'd love to hear a bit more. Kia ora.
Kia ora. Well, I was born in Whakatane, and I spent the first sort of year and a half of my life sort of peddling between Kawerau and Ruatoki, where where parts of my family were living at the time, before we moved back to Wellington and then to Lower Hutt after that. But I consider Taihape home. I moved there when I was 12 years old, and it's the edge of my heart. I love that place, and it's where all of my formative education, especially in relation to te reo, and also tikanga and most of the work that we did with wānanga. Actually, a lot of the wānanga we did was based down in Kaiwi, Carl. So we were very, very lucky at that particular point to have our tohunga reo there. We had Ruka Broughton. Wow. and Sunny Waru. They were there, and of course Huirangi was there as well. So I was really lucky that during my formative years at school, we travelled to Kaiwi maybe 10 or 15 times over a year to partake in workshops there, learning about. I think it was unbelievable. It was just a thing. That's really sort of where my formative years sort of built it up. My Ngāti Kahu side came in a little bit later in the piece. Sort of into my early 20s when I really began to understand sort of a little bit more about my background, and I'm still working to learn as much as I possibly can. Luckily, my auntie Margaret, she's written a fantastic book called Te Whanau Moana, which tells of our family history and has a fantastic whakapapa in there. So that's something that's very precious to me and something I treasure very much. And I enjoy sharing with my children, you know, with them starting to show an interest in all things Maori now as well.
Good point. I mean, that's the reality for a lot of us too, is it's our Maori upbringing is not necessarily where our ancestors came from. You know, our parents would sometimes have moved away, like mine did. They moved to Wellington, and it's there you have your upbringing. You're interacting with other Maori in the community who might not necessarily be from your tribal community, but it makes us who we are, you know, and we all have our unique upbringings. And like me, for, you know, going back to Ngāti Maru was something I did that was a lot older. I was in my early 20s, and I, you know, had all these questions about who I was through my mother, and that was, it took me an effort to go back and find that out through my personal journey. So tell me about moving from, you know, well, now you're in another part of the world, completely on the other side, so there's a bit to cover. But yeah, tell us about the journey, and I remember you talking about, well, one, going to law school, Te Kana, and the other one, Les Mills, and I know those sort of been part of your journey over in getting over here.
Yeah, well, when I moved from New Zealand at the end of 1995, and where I was attached to the New Zealand Embassy in Bonn, so I came over and was based in Germany for 3 years, but prior to that, I've been based in Wellington like pretty much the whole time. My sort of work history was that I'd worked at the Māori Land Court in Whanganui before I went came down to Wellington to go to university, and I continued that at the head office there, working with the deputy head judge at that time, was Ashley McHugh, and then from there I was lucky enough to basically jump on a brand new sort of a brand new area, which was actually some Māori tourism development. So I took over the role heading the Māori tourism area at a tourism board in the early 90s, and that was an amazing time. That was right when we were sort of diverging out from, you know, from things like whakarewarewa, which was the major products, out into the Kaikoura whale watch period. And it was at that particular time, you know, Māori tourism was very much at its infancy stage. And it was really, really a really interesting time to come in and be in some ex officio board member at the Māori Arts and Crafts Centre, which was really a real eye-opener for me, but which taught me a lot as well. After that, then I was working with Howie Tamati and Waimarama Taumonu at the Hillary Commission. So they were head of Māori sport, and I was working with sports financing for high performance athletes, which was absolutely amazing. So that was a mixture of high performance work with that, and also at the same time through the aerobics works, which I'll come back to now, which is as an ambassador for Smoke Free, and that was just prior to starting at the starting at the Foreign Affairs and Trade, which took me to Germany.
I remember seeing pictures of you in leotards and aerobics. You're really young and fit and on fire.
Yeah, I remember those days too.
Well, I mean, you're talking about back in the 90s, so it's a long time ago. And yeah. I was around then, of course, and I was young, and there was so much happening. And I remember listening to Wally from Kaikoura Tours, with the wild tours back at that time, and that was something so new to see a Maori business out there competing. It was an exciting time. So it's great to hear that you come through all that. And how did this end up in Copenhagen? Because you've been there about 20 years now, Copenhagen, yep, haven't you? Yeah.
Yep. So after Germany, I was offered a job up in Copenhagen, so I came to work for which was an incubator, part of Saatchi & Saatchi, where I was working as a strategic planner there. So my job basically was working on because it was all about sort of, there wasn't a lot of English support and resources, so I was doing a lot of writing and just looking after sort of the English work that was coming through the agency, which was a lot of fun. And then I started at SAS at the airline. which was a really fantastic job. It was the first real business area that I'd sort of worked in, which was developing business on behalf of the airline, mostly to do with airline services. We were the first in the world to create booking kiosks, first in the world to do telephone booking for people for flights, first in the world to do internet in flights. It was a fantastic time. And we had another New Zealander who I was working very, very closely with, who was just an amazing guy himself. And he was just the two of us working together. It was just so much fun. And we just attacked things with the same sort of Kiwi verve. And I think that it was just really a lot of fun. And then after that, I came back into the law area, where I came in as a consultant working with different companies, actually doing what they call Red Squad, Blue Squad, which was basically going in and helping, going up against negotiators and helping to try to find out where their weaknesses and so on are. And I did that with the Danish police, with a Danish shipping company called Maersk, and finally with a Danish pharmaceutical company called Novo Nordisk. Yeah.
Okay. But yeah, I just wanted to touch on that comment that you made. It's something you hear quite a bit over here is that New Zealanders, they come overseas and we don't sort of have the same understanding in some ways, which is an advantage, of the different cultural structures or the class, the elites. That all sort of goes beyond us, and we just be who we are without that inhibiting who we are. So yeah. It's a real advantage in the corporate world over here, and also this can-do attitude. You know, you just get up and do things. If it needs to be done, you're not sitting there waiting for somebody else to do it. You know, you don't worry about your own position within the organization. You just make sure it gets done. So I think it's a real advantage.
But a really good example of that, coming back to what we were talking about before, was Les Mills, actually. I mean, Les Mills, which started off in the sort of early 80s as a single gym in Auckland, you know, it's basically a global juggernaut now. It's the biggest provider of group fitness training in the world. And it's been a real leader during this whole COVID time. It's been wonderful to hear just glowing reviews from the fitness world about how amazing Les Mills have been in providing resources and providing classes to people, you know, who have essentially been locked out of their gyms and locked into their homes. And so Les Mills opened their putia, opened up their basket, and just gave and gave and gave and gave, and I'm just so proud of what they've done. It just so underlines the very essence of the whole push overseas, which was actually by there's five specific people who traveled overseas. All of them came from ethnic backgrounds, most of them Maori. So we had straight away, we had that can-do attitude, we had that warrior attitude, but we also had that manaakitanga, being able to host and listen and understand and handle things with humility. Mm. And I think that's just the big difference between why it's been so successful and what it's actually achieved. And I think that in New Zealand, you've got it's the biggest gym chain, but apart from that, the fact of the matter is that people just don't realize just how huge it is, on a global stage.
But also being huge at the same time, this is what we spoke about before before we went online, is the response that New Zealand made to COVID-19 and how we were able to respond really quickly and decisively. And I think that's partly to do with our size, that we're not that large and clumsy as compared to other nations and don't have so many layers of bureaucracy to deal with. Yep. But I also think it reflects what you were just saying before about the attitude of New Zealanders and, in the example you gave with Les Mills. So there's an interesting theme that's coming through, because I think it really helps us move into, what I'm trying to do in this podcast is really just trying to peel back some layers and understand what's going on with us being able to share our cultural knowledge in a more specific way, and what it is that appeals to others about what we do, and because they're interested in what we do and how we do it. So interested in hearing your journey with Haka X and how that all started. Do you want to give us some background?
Well, I'll start by saying it's certainly, I never at any stage in my life ever thought that I would be fortunate enough to be working with with the Maori culture in any way, shape, or form, apart from, you know, in a sort of a business type situation. But what it actually came down to was just over 3 years now. I was invited to come on to the Danish morning television show, The Good Morning Show, to talk about a viral wedding haka that was that I think that everybody watching has probably seen before, which came out, which was this amazing haka, which was filmed at a wedding. And I think that for a lot of people, it was the first real time that they actually saw the Maori, the male and the female elements in full flight. And I think that what was really interesting was that it just began to affect a lot of people. And what actually happened was that I was asked to go in and talk about it on the morning show. And so so I gathered together a few of our local Kiwis here to come in and support me so that we could do a haka on screen. But basically what happened on that day was it was actually one of the 100-year-old storms in Denmark. It was a really, really bad day, and what ended up happening was that the 4 minutes or so that we were supposed to be online ended up being almost 20 minutes in total, because people couldn't get to the studio because of the bad weather. So we ended up teaching the hosts, talking about the culture in depth, and actually really giving people a really good understanding of what it was. Then finally we performed it, and I thought, well, that was that. Then I sort of knew something was going on because my wife and my kids, we were down shopping later on that day, and these people just keep walking past going, hey, that's that guy from TV. Hey, blah, hey, that's that guy from TV. And I was going, oh, okay. And my kids were sort of looking at me, what did you do? Because they saw, of course, on TV as well. But the big thing was the next morning when I woke up and I checked my Facebook, and there's almost 500 messages there from individuals who were touched by the emotion and the feeling of the haka, right through to companies, corporate HR people, CEOs who were just struggling to really find something that they can just motivate and build strength in their team. And basically that's where it kicked off from. It's the way that it went, but all the rest of my work over time began to get less and less as this became more and more, and I began to find my feet. And I think that the idea of having connecting the kaupapa with business, but also with the performance side, which has been very dear to my heart over the years with my aerobics and stuff as well. So so being able to connect those three things it formed a perfect triad. And so that was the genesis of where we were.
Yeah. So you got the triad in terms of your Maori culture, your corporate background, and your performance background all coming together. Yep. But I think it's intriguing. You know, I mean, you might want to explain to us a bit more about Danish culture and people from Scandinavia, and you know, the, I suppose we might be talking in generalizations, but their temperament, and then just contrasting that with our culture, you know, and the emotion that comes through haka. It seems like a long way apart, you know, and
yeah.
And so, I mean, there's two things that can do. One, it could, you know, attract, or it can repel, you know, and I just really want to understand a bit more about how people respond to haka over in your part of the world.
Sure. I think, first of all, it really comes back to two things. I think that the world itself is we're moving at such a tick, you know, we're moving along at such a fast pace, and I think that people are finding it difficult to find time for themselves, not only in the personal realm, but also finding more place for themselves in their businesses and in their workplace. So I think that this is something that. There is a change in a commonality that actually lives. I think it's, and I don't think it necessarily has to do with anything to do with it culturally or where people actually come from. I think that's a very humanistic type of thing, which I think has been laying underneath and been bubbling for a long time. But specifically here in Scandinavia, it's a really interesting thing for me, because growing up in my culture and also, you know, having, you know, in having multiple situations where we stand up against we stand up against ideas that we don't support, and where we use haka and we use our waiata, our songs, to, you know, to talk about these issues and to show our solidarity and also to show that we are against these things. That it's for me to go from there to Scandinavia, where the voice is basically seen as being a thing that you put to the back. It's a very quiet society in comparison to us, until you sort of get behind the walls and you get to sort of know them a little bit better. But understanding also that one of the things that's really interesting about Scandinavia is that, of course, they come from a Viking culture, but their Viking culture is long gone. And for many of them, they're struggling and they feel that remnants in their DNA. And when they hear the haka, and when they hear the sounds of the voices extruding, you know, in a passionate and open and really strong way, it harkens back to the times, you know, of the longboats and you know, of the, you know, of going out and attacking, you know, attacking the coast of the United States and England and, you know, and Saxony and all through there. There's a very strong pull in their DNA, but they just don't recognize it. Recognize how to use it or how to actually connect with it in a way.
Yeah.
And that's why I think that a lot of people are, especially people who have been in, you know, maybe repressed culturally and you know, for example, in like in Germany, for example, we have a lot of success in Germany with people who really understand, you know, what we're doing, especially, you know, by using this in a business sense. But I think that's really what it comes down to is that people, they feel it before they actually understand it.
Yeah.
And I think a part of our role is to ensure that we are taking good care of our taonga. We're taking very, very good care of the way that we do our work. We're taking very good care of what we're portraying and what we're sharing, but also, you know, setting the boundaries and setting the limits for what this can be used for and how it can be used. And I think that's one of the things that we've discussed a number of times that I think a lot of people struggle with.
Yeah. Kapai, brother. No, it's beautiful and certainly something I can recognize. Hey, I'm just going to ask you to do something. Your earphone thing is tapping on your taonga. Yeah, so it's just making a bit of a tap as you when you get enthusiastic with your kōrero.
Which is pretty much all the time.
Hey, I just want to say I acknowledge what you're saying, you know, and it's similar here as well. Like, we go out and perform haka and I take my, you know, couple with me, and, you know, there's a myriad of responses really, but they all come back to the same thing. I mean, some, you know, people like are moved, but often they don't know what to do with their feelings. You know, that we make them feel something, but they're in this corporate environment wearing suits and really quite, you know, stiff, and everyone's sitting in rows watching us, and then we're making them feel really quite out of it, and they don't know what to do with their feelings. But and some of them start to laugh because they're just embarrassed, you know, they're nervous. We make them feel nervous. We're reminding them of something that's really deep inside, that they've, you know, repressed, pushed away. And I think in our Western culture, we've been trained from a really young age to push that side of us away. But for Maori, it's about us being able to go to recognize it really quickly and just connect with it just like that. And we've got rituals which help us to do that, you know. So we're introducing these ideas, these rituals, to enable other people to do that. So it's like an awakening. It's empowering for people. And what needs to happen, though, is, and I think this is what you were saying before and what I'd like to hear your view on again, is that we need to do it so that they go through this journey in quite a safe way, that they're understanding what's going on, that they can really commit to the process and come out the other end knowing a bit more about themselves, you know, being a bit more clear about the fuller extent of who they are as a human. And I mean, there's the danger we don't do that. There's a danger that we just, work, you know, take the nervousness that they have and turn it into something that they can laugh along with or even laugh at, you know, to make them feel okay. And that's not what we're about. We're about breaking that down, getting through it, and taking them to another place. Yeah, just want to hear your thoughts on that, really.
I've been lucky enough to travel with you and do a fantastic event together, which was really amazing for me because a lot of the work that I do is obviously by myself. But one of the things that I've sort of come to realize, and I think it's really hit home during during the lockdown here in Denmark, is the fact that we have been in a situation where we have been teaching they've been teaching our taonga, and we've been doing our very best to ensure that what is passed on from us to our clients in a business sense reflects 100% the tikanga of the experience and also of everything that lies underneath the foundation of what we're doing. But one of the things that has sort of come back to me over this time is I think that one of the things that we're so good at is we're really good at pivoting. Maori can see opportunities and can see situations and move with grace from one situation to another situation, as we find with our young Maori now who can speak the language, moving from te reo Maori to te reo Pākehā and all the area in between. But I think that we lack innovation. I think that the idea of what we do, I think it's still super relevant, especially in the idea of being able to give people that opportunity to actually feel, get themselves in a place where they are, they're taking a journey, but they're not taking this journey alone. They're looking to the left and the right of them, and they're taking a journey with people that they have a viewpoint on, or they see, and they're changing in front of them. And I think that certainly has its place, and that's an amazing thing. But I think that the strength of our future is going to be in understanding the value of our traditions and our tikanga, but not only that, but also our stories and our history, and being able to use that as impetus to help develop product that focuses on building stronger, more authentic and innovative cultures. Because I think that we have done that again and again and again and again through the Spanish flu, through measles, and through polio, now COVID. We are stepping up to it, we're looking at it, we're assessing it, we're reevaluating it, we're finding the best way out of it, and we're moving out of it. And I think that this is the thing that we can begin to, I think that we should really begin to open our eyes a little bit more and begin to look at, okay, how can we expand what we do and what we love with the teaching side of it, but actually beginning to make it so that we can begin to bring people and to take what we know as knowledge and take it back to New Zealand. And begin to filter that back into all these amazing young people who are coming, coming through the education system, fully loaded with all of the resources that they need, but not necessarily understanding the way that the map is being read. And that's really where my focus is now. Like I love what I'm still going to continue doing what I'm doing. But the teaching part or the haka part of it is becoming less and less as I move through the sort of work that I'm doing. It's not less important, but it just means that for me that the questions that are being asked of me and the requirements that are being asked of me from the clients require me to take other things into consideration before bringing that in. But everything is still based and grounded on my upbringing as a Maori.
I suppose I want to comment on that, and just my experience of that. I mean, we started Haka Works, well, Manaia 15 years ago, and Haka Works sort of came in about a year later. And I mean, it was a big thing. It was scary, to be able to say, hey, we're teaching Haka, and we didn't tell a lot of people at first, and it's been slowly. As we've taken the journey, we've been taking our time and exploring just the limits of that. And this is part of this show is about that. But I suppose where I started to see this is in terms of innovation is competition. So when I started getting competitors, prior to getting competitors, a client would say, hey, we love what you're doing, but we want you to do this, you know? And I'd just say, no, we don't do it like that. I was brought up this way. This is how we were trained as people, and this is what I'm going to share with you. And the funny thing is, you know, that was quite a limited view now. When I look at it now, it's limited. And it wasn't until competition came along when, and then you start thinking, okay, well, if I don't say, find a way to help my client, then someone else will, you know? And then you think, what can I fall on to be able to help my goal, my client achieve their goals? And then, of course, you go back your culture, and then you start to realize that actually the questions that my clients have, we already have a particular solution, you know, it's been developed for us,
exactly,
with Maori. But actually, how can I share that with them in a way which is going to make them, go through the same, come out with the same outcome? It's not always going to be the same, you know, you're not always going to go through the same route, but you can start with those building blocks of tikanga that you've been brought up with, and then say, how do they apply to the situation? And what I learned, and I think what you're alluding to, is that there's nearly every situation that we have to deal with as Maori, we have a set of tikanga or knowledge that has been passed down to us to be able to deal with that situation. I mean, and I'm talking quite broad values and principles. But it's there, you know, and that's been really exciting for me to learn and to understand, and you know, it enables us to grow as practitioners as well. And again, I agree, it's not just haka. I mean, haka is the stuff that people see, but actually, what's going on behind that to ensure that people are able to achieve that heightened state of expression? And there's a whole lot of values that and connections that help us do that, and that's what people really want to know about.
I also think that as we push the boundaries more and more, one of the things I decided right from the word go was that and I think, you know, I'm a very competitive person in under normal circumstances, but I made a very, very clear decision right at the beginning that in this particular case I'm not going to bother about competition, because I think that what we have, everybody who is contributing to the space at the moment comes with like amazing backgrounds and, you know, experiences that redefine us and actually, you know, and define us separately in what we're doing. So I don't feel, for example, competitive with you, or I don't feel competitive with any of the other people around the world, because I just will celebrate that, you know, if you're out there doing something like when you guys were in the States recently, I was just like, I was your biggest cheerleader. I love the idea that you guys were over there doing, you know, doing something that was so innovative and beginning to do something, you know, in the online space, which was, you know, I just thought was fantastic. But I think that the other thing too is that, you know, we're often faced with criticism from home, from other sources who have their own sort of ideas and understandings of what they feel is the correct thing for the Maori culture. And you know, and I you know, and without having more knowledge about what their backgrounds are and so on, you know, I just take that in and accept that as another sort of jigsaw puzzle piece to add to the bigger picture. But like we've had this discussion before, and like my vision is much bigger. My vision is something that places Maori in a situation where we can have much more control over our resources. We can have much more control over our taonga, both in the design area, on the online area, and as a legal sense. And I think that there are certain things that I hope will be tested over the next, you know, sort of year or so, in regards to, you know, to actually be able to protect our taonga away from New Zealand, because honestly, the government's doing a horrible job of looking after our taonga. Mm. But I'm going to stand and I'm going to put my head up here and now say Maori aren't doing a very good job of it either.
Mm.
Okay. I think that specifically what I mean is the sense that if we want to try and protect our taonga in the big world, then we have to use the tools that the big world uses. So we're talking legal, you know, about from the legal perspective, and also, you know, and also from a perspective of being able to actually talk about culture and protection of our culture, and doing that. But we can only do that in a manner as if we decide to take up the fight. And we're getting there, but we're not there yet.
Yeah, I mean, everybody has to, you know, got their own individual way of sort of reconciling these issues. And I mean, we've been around, you know, it's been a lot of thought gone into, you know, how we approach this. And I think, I suppose the question I want to ask you really, and this is the question I ask myself. I mean, you talked about Ruka Broughton and Huirangi Waikerepuru and Sunny Waru, and I mean, I don't think the answer's a straight yes or no, but I think, you know, I always ask myself, would they be happy with what we're doing? And I suppose, I mean, ultimately, I think yes. but also, I'm quite aware that what we're doing is not something that they may have conceived doing or, you know, happening back at their time. So I think you look at the what you need to do in these sort of situations and look at the deeper principles that a person operates, you know, and are they going ahead doing this with good intent? And, you know, again, that's something that we all need to reconcile ourselves with and be happy about. But, yeah, I just want to, I mean, at the same time, there's a lot of stuff I see online which I'm not happy about, you know, and I think, why is that group doing haka? Who are they? You know, teaching that, and I'm sure, you know, people might see us doing the same thing and us have the same questions, and you don't know the answer to those questions, and sometimes the answer will satisfy you, but, you know, when you look at what people share sometimes, you think, I don't think that person should be teaching this, because they're not Maori, or even if they're they might be New Zealanders and have no understanding, or they might be Maori and have no understanding, you know, of some of the ideas that come from haka, which underpin haka. You know, what are your thoughts on that, Kane?
I think the time when I was a teenager, and sort of in the beginning of the 80s, was a different time. But even at that particular point, you know, people like Ruka Broughton, they were devising opportunities for Maori arts and crafts to travel the world through, for example, Futu Maori. And, you know, so I think that if they were alive as a unit, I think they would be powering Maori forward. I think they would have pulled together. One of the things I loved about Sunny was the fact that he was, the way he communicated, apart from, especially at that particular time, because I really had very little knowledge of te reo at that time, yet he could tell a story in te reo that I could understand through emotion, that inspired me. And I think that's what I would hope that they would be looking at us and going, you know, kapai, and just, you know, our virtues are true, and especially in relation to what we're trying to do and what we do, and I think that irrespective of what the end game is, because I think, you know, there's going to be a lot of different end games, and COVID's going to change everything. I think COVID, as we discussed just before we came online today, that I believe that COVID is going to really have an impact on Maori and Maori's ability to go out into the world. I think finally a lot of people are going to really begin to understand just the value of what we actually have. And it's my opinion that the indigenous value or the value of Maori could actually be the blueprint in a number of ways to actually to help other indigenous countries and indigenous nations to rise and to you know, to move their stories and their backgrounds and their experiences forward into their local marketplaces.
I think too, it's I mean, you touched on this twice now, and it's storytelling. And if anything, you know, you look for a thread that comes through from our childhood, and being in front of those old people and seeing them speak. And even my mum, you know, my mother was just this amazing storyteller, and would just have us mesmerized for hours sitting at the table listening to her child stories about her childhood and seeing those old people. And, you know, they spoke in, often it was in Maori. You couldn't understand all the time what they were talking about, but it was the way they stood and the way they spoke and the tone of their voice and their body language and how, it's right inside of us, you know, and we were so lucky to have those times with those old people. And I agree. I think people are looking for purpose within work now, increasingly so with COVID-19. And, you know, people are starting to understand that through, you know, about organizational culture and how it's about values and purpose. And they want to start defining their purpose and using it to bring people together. And they don't really have the skills to do that. At the same time, I do think, you know, because what we do is so instinctive and sort of learned from, and these are quite complex skills to be able to share and pass on, you know, it's, I think, and sometimes you get an hour with a client, you know, or you might have a program where you get these momentary points with them. And it's very difficult for these ideas to be transferred in a really complex, meaningful way.
The work that we're doing at Haka X actually sort of addresses that perfectly. What's been happening is that we're four people who are based in and around Germany as our main headquarters, and our major focus is actually using existing. Like we're actually looking at existing types of teachings and skills that are out there, and just sort of seeing, okay, well, what is it that's out there that actually has that we can maybe use as a pivot point for the things that we can add from the Maori culture, and one of the things that we've actually developed is quite radical in the sense that we have been working over the last year on something that's actually been available for a number of years now. It's called a Google Design Sprint, and the Design Sprint was originally set up to develop business process for IT. With the idea being that people can come in and over a 1 to 4 day period can actually develop and prototype ideas prior to them actually being introduced into the workplace. So one of the things we came across very quickly was the idea was, okay, well, let's, what they're doing in the design sprint is fantastic, but the reality is that this work and the type of work that they're doing, there's a lot of people doing this. There's a lot of stuff around. And we recognize very quickly that one of the areas that's not being captured is culture, and so we've gone back and basically looked at the process and we've actually begun to actually develop a culture sprint where we actually use the fundamentals of the Maori culture as a basically as a point of reference, but not specifically taking into the things we use them for. Like, for example, we might be talking about specific things in relation to authentic communication, which is a very strong part of it, cultural innovation in relation to the workplace and also on a personal level, and finally bravery. So obviously you can see that those themes work very quickly and very closely in with the Maori world as well. But what we've done is we've defined them in a manner so that the company or the client that we're using derives value out of what we do from helping them develop their own unique and strong culture. And what this ends up doing is providing providing them and us with an ongoing dialogue, which can, you know, which works to our advantage over the long point, you know, as becoming a trusted partner. But what it also does is it also means that we can continue to test hypotheses and ideas in the workplace on a purely cultural view, and still with the group that we have, coming from marketing, from the military, logistics, coming from academia as well, we have people who really understand what is required to drive a business in that way. And we've been able to find some really amazing trigger points. So we're really excited to once COVID comes out to push it again and to restart our workshops.
Good point. Well, I'm looking forward to hearing more about that someday, Kane, in the future. So all the best with that one. Hey, I just want to say a couple of people saying hi, so we've got Lei Angela from Tongva Land, which is in Los Angeles. She says kia ora. Got Keith Wolf saying hello, brother. Keith. Andrew Gunman here in the UK, in London. Ripika Burke. Kia ora, Ripika. Ngamahi ki a koe. And Sine Frank Rasmussen, and sending his aroha, his love.
Well, she's, yep. Well, I hope so. That's my wife, so.
Okay. Directed at you, there you go.
Thanks, David.
Hey, I just want to, just having this mihi from Lei Angela from the Tongva Lands, which is the native people in Los Angeles, just made me think a little bit about what's happening over there right now. And I'd just love to hear your thoughts with Black Lives Matter and the protests that are happening. Have you got any kōrero about that?
It's a real tough one. I think that it's given me pause in the sense that I think that what I've known and sort of in my life and also from the Maori perspective, there are a lot of touch points which are where we can sort of recognize what's been going on over there. But I think that the whole situation in the United States is really a tinderbox. I think that what you can do is to embrace at the strongest level humanity, and to understand that tragedies and things have happened over generations and generations and generations, and this is just the first infant crawling steps out of the smoke, as we can say. I think Maori will have I think we can maybe provide some impetus at some point. I'm not too sure how or where that will be. To be honest, I'm still working it through. I don't have a reaction to it. A horrible situation, and what happened to that gentleman and his family is tragic. But it's not surprising.
Mm. So. Do you think New Zealand's racist as fuck as Taika Waititi says?
I don't know about as fuck, but I think that we're the same as any growing nation. Like every country has a certain amount of racism to it. Denmark has a certain amount of racism to it. Sweden has a certain. There are always going to be issues until such time as we embrace a single idea of unity in a real and meaningful way. But again, that comes back to the idea of authenticity, and people are going to be who they are. And if they are who they are, then all you can do at that particular point is trust that if you have a disagreement or you no longer wish to, you do not understand the other point of view, is that you have the patience and the humility and empathy to be able to listen. You don't necessarily have to agree, but when you listen, then at least at that particular point, views can be exchanged. And so I don't know how it's going to go.
I just want to say I agree. It feels like it's a huge thing. It feels so big. It feels difficult for us to comprehend or really understand what they're going through. and there's a long way to go, a huge way to go. And I think, my view is people are inherently racist. And all I mean by that is that we're designed to, going back to the DNA, we're designed to live in tribes where we're all the same, and anyone that's different, and we look at them with suspicion, and that's if you're physically different. And I think even though we live in societies now where those differences aren't, we're not meant to recognize them, I think, deep down, they just are, And I think once people are conscious of that, that's how they can change their behavior. Once they go, once they're able to catch their thoughts and the negativeness and their their language or their body language, and just that minute quarter of a second of a thought that goes through your head. I think it comes from a long way away, you know, when we were afraid of other people who are different. So I think that exists in all of us, but I just think it's catching ourselves and understanding it and then saying, okay, if we want an equal society, we need to find ways to be more enlightened and for people to move ahead in with equality.
I think one of the interesting things, I think, is if you don't catch yourself, someone's going to catch you.
Yeah.
So, and I think that's the thing now. People are using their voices in a, you know, they're not afraid just to actually, you know, just stand up and use their voices to shout down obscenities in that particular way. And I don't know.
Good point. Well, just want to say thanks for Lei Angela for joining in. We also got Bruce Simpson.
Yeah, kia ora, Bruce.
Kia ora, Kazis, he says. And Dino, Dino's a whanaunga relation of mine in Canada, in Toronto.
So
all right, where are we? I think we're pretty close to the end. I think, I mean, I think we already touched on this, but I just, if you had any other thoughts about what we can share. I mean, in some ways, haka's been the easy thing to do because it stands out, you know, and people go, wow, we want some of that. Without them really knowing what they really want. And, you know, our job has been to unpack what they really want, which is the connection aspect, which haka brings.
Yep.
I mean, that's a simple way of saying it. But I think there's so much more, and you've touched on this. Do you want to expand?
I believe our greatest times are ahead of us. I believe that we are building strength and building agility every day. I think that the next generation will thrill us in the manner that they choose to express themselves in the world. I think our language and our culture will become a really strong point of pride for Aotearoa, for New Zealand, not only in the sense that it's as being a visual mouthpiece through the All Blacks and through other things on a global stage, but the fact that our culture will be recognized in a number of different tiers of reference, from academia right through to humanities. In the next 5 years, I'm super excited to see how people are going to begin to migrate again. As we talked about our canoes traveling to New Zealand, I think we're going to start to see our canoes migrating apart away from New Zealand as people begin to lift up the taki and lift up the challenges and the things that are around the world, but also to find ideas and to find solutions that are uniquely Maori. And that's what excites me, is that I think we are an amazing race that is shown to be an amazing race that's just going to change everything. That's how I feel about it. So
I love the way you because we are past facing in a lot of ways, the way somebody put it this morning was that we give equal weighting to the past and the future. And I love the way you look at into the future and are excited about it so much. Kane, what can old guys like me and you do to help the new generation coming through?
I think one thing is that is we just need to continue supporting each other. I think that we are effectively, we're still alone over here. You know, we have some amazing people who are working, you know, like our cousin Bruce, who was on just before, and Sol and guys who work all throughout, you know, with the world and the media, of course, and back in New Zealand, but in the US, there are people who are going to be the sounding boards, and we just need to keep communicating and keep positioning ourselves to take on these opportunities, but also develop things. And this is what it comes back to before. I think we need to be more innovative. I think we need to, don't be scared to fail. I think we need to try some stuff. And I think that this has been, you know, this has always been the Maori way. You know, we do the best we possibly can. We find out what we can do, and then we just do better. And the way we can do that is continue to communicate and to keep talking. And then we need to go home. We need to go home, and we need to tell the stories of what we've done and how we've done it. And I'm really looking forward to to us doing that. It'll be fun.
Ka pai. Well, kei te mihi ki a koe Ngāti Kahu. Kei roto I te whare I tēnei wā, e pai tō kōrero. Yeah, just want to say thanks. Thanks for, it's been really, I really enjoyed talking to you. And we always we always buzz off when we get the kōrero. So, well, I just want to say thanks to you for just sort of showing a picture moving forward, because it is a difficult message to get caught up in the, you know, the ua ua tanga. Like, it's like walking through a muddy path at times, and your feet get stuck and it's really difficult and you're just wondering whether or not you're going the right way, you know, especially with COVID happening.
Yep.
So it's nice to hear you painting a picture of a bright future.
Absolutely.
So, ka pai, kua mutu I konei. I'm one of, you know, as we know, we finished with waiata in our culture, and I can see a shadow of a guitar in the picture next to you.
There might be just one right down there, yep.
There was a sign for you to sing to finish us off, so if you could do that, that'd be really wonderful.
Yeah, but okay. I'm just gonna, so this song is, I'm just going to move my thing, excuse me for a moment, so I can see it over here somewhere. Okay, this song is dedicated to my auntie, to Manua Kori Leach, who was an amazing teacher at Taihape College. She brought back with her a number of songs from her time in Auckland at Hoane Waititi, and also through her whanaunga, some through all the way down through to Wharetoa, right down back to Taihape. So if it's I'd like just to sing a little song for you guys. As we do in Maori, we end our kōrero with a song as a way to bring the rhythm and the sounds and the music together. So so this is a little sort of smile back to my hometown, back to Taihape, and to all those warriors who are working with Te Reo Maori and learning the language. Kia ora. Ki roto I te reo hautapu, ki raro o rua pehue. Takutu mai ra o Ngāti Tama, ki Taihape. Hapa e tia mai ra te kōpapa, ki mihia nei ngā tuwira. Nā mai piki mai ki te ata, koroma kuima. Te pueru tiki tiki, tuku whakarere iho, ao tato matua tupuna, puritia ki te reo. Puritia ki te reo. Tēnta mihatu ki a koutou. Kia ora.